Well, hey, kids, welcome back to the creek. I am so glad to see you here. You know what old Rusty was doing the other day? I was walking down here by the creek, and I had my shoes off, and I was just enjoying sticking my feet down in the cold water. It was so refreshing. But I tell you what, when I got out of the water, guess what I had in between my toes? Yeah, I had all that sandy, gritty, dirty stuff in between my toes. And so before I could put my socks and shoes back on, had to brush all that dirt off, had to get in between my toes and rub all that out. Has that ever happened to you? It might not have ever happened when you're walking by the creek, but I bet it's happened to you like when you've gone to see the ocean. How many of you have been to see the ocean sometime? I bet you a bunch of you have. And you know that part of the that you run out on when you're running out to see the ocean? What is that called? That's called the beach, right? It's covered in sand. There's sand as far as you can see up the beach, and as far as you can see down the beach, there is sand everywhere. And when you run in that sand, you know that gets stuck between your toes too. You have to rinse it off, you have to brush it off. But have you ever just sat down before you even got in the water and just played in the sand? You ever picked up a handful of sand and just looked at it? It's amazing how many grains of sand can fit in your hand when you have a handful of sand. It's a whole bunch of grains of sand, I tell you that. Now, that is an important question. How many grains of sand can you fit in your hand? That's an important question. But you have to hang around here at Creek Night tonight to find out why that's an important question. I hope you'll stay for the whole night and you'll enjoy everything that we have going on here at the creek tonight. I tell you what, we're going to start off with singing a really fun song, and I hope that you will give it your all. It's called I Want to Do Right. And the Bible tells us how we can do right and how we can live a life that's pleasing to God. And you're going to find out about it as we sing this song together. So I hope that you'll sing and give it your all. You can do the motions if you want to, or you can just sing the song. But let's enjoy this song together.
Up there now. I don't want you to burn the whole creek down, okay? Wow. Woo. lot going. Well, hey, boys and girls, you remember me, Cookie Joe. I hadn't been there with you in a couple of weeks. We had some really great special guests the last couple of weeks, didn't we? And then before that, I think Rufus was up here. I was down there helping clean up on the river. And now, though, Cookie Joe's back. I hope y'all have had a great time with these other folks. Boy, I tell you, we got a lot going on up at the creek today. Look at this. Our second annual Creek Kids Barbecue Cook-Off is coming up. I got them jokers over there with their grills. They all starting their grills and getting them fire going up everywhere. And I'm going to tell you something. They can cook all day long if they want to. But I'm going to tell you something. They ain't going to beat Cookie Joe. Look at here. You know what this trophy's for? And you know who it was given to? You're right. This trophy was given to Cookie Joe as the winner of last year's Creek Kids Barbecue Cook-Off. And you know what won it for me? Well, I'll tell you in just a minute. Well, I'll go ahead and tell you now. It was my secret sauce. And that's what I've come down here back to the snack shack to whip up is my secret sauce. Because you know, some of them people may try and get it. And they might try and use it. No. Cookie Joe going to. But I also want to do something very special for you. When we do this barbecue cook-off this year, now they're not all these, everybody don't like barbecue. Ooh, I love barbecue. But not everybody does. So I came back here with this grill and I'm going to start this grill up and we're going to get it going real good. So when y'all come down here, if you don't like barbecue, guess what? We got hamburgers, hot dogs, chicken fingers for you. And so you can eat that instead of the barbecue. But listen, try the barbecue. I think you're going to like it. So I got to get this going. I brought all the things I would need just in case the barbecue goes a little woo-hoo, you know. I got me some fire extinguishers. I hope you got your fire extinguishers at home because you may need them sometime. And then I got all my cooking utensils ready to go, my flippers. And I'm ready. All I got to do is start this grill right here. And if I start this grill, it'll smoke up a little bit. And then we'll put the hamburgers, hot dogs here. And we'll go up there. And I got my grill off to the side. We're going to cook us up some Cookie Joe barbecue. And right in this pot right here, boys and girls. Yeah, boy. On that burner, on the side burner of my grill, going to be cooking up some special sauce. But first, let's get this one going, shall we? Let's go ahead and get this going. You know, sometimes when you put the charcoal in the grill, the charcoal just don't want to light like it's supposed to. So they've made this charcoal lighter stuff that you can just put on it. And it then you put the fire to it and it goes. Now, boys and girls, let me tell you something. Never, ever, ever. Let me say that one more time. Don't you ever, ever, ever play with fire around your house. Because I'm going to tell you something. You can get hurt really quickly. And you can hurt a lot of other people, okay? So don't play with fire, okay? Even if you got you one of these fire extinguishers, or as I like to call them, fire putter-outers, don't even play with it if you got one of these, okay? Now, all I gotta do is get this started, whip a little lighter out, and then I can flip me some hamburgers and roll around some hot dogs for you, okay? So let's get this thing started. Whew. And we'll get some good stuff going. I'm going to put on some of that fire starter upper stuff, okay? You know, this don't look like that fire. Uh-oh. Cookie Joe done messed up. You know what this is I'm spraying on that charcoal down there? I'm spraying creek water on it. This is the jar I keep my creek water in that I put in my possum pie to give it that wild taste. And I've been spraying water all over this charcoal. There is my fire starter upper stuff. But here, I've been throwing water on it. Now, I don't know about you. I don't know much about science, boys and girls. But I do know if you put water on something, it's hard to get it started on fire. You can't build fire where there's water. I guess we're just going to have to wait a while and let this dry out. Maybe the sun will dry it out real soon and we can get back to cooking the hamburgers and hot dogs. In the meantime, you know what? I was wrong. Cookie Joe made a mistake. Let me tell you a story about the only time that I know of that somebody used water and a fire started. It's in the Bible. You know, last week somebody started talking to you about this guy named Elijah. Elijah was a prophet of God. Now, a prophet of God was somebody that God used to speak his words and show people who God was in the Old Testament. And so Elijah was a mighty man of God. Boy, he was something else. And here's what happened. Now, you learned last week about Elijah and the woman that had all that oil that she needed. Well, you know, Elijah, the people around Elijah, the nation of Israel, decided they weren't going to worship God no more. And they decided what they were going to do is they were going to follow this guy, this idol called Baal. Okay? Not a bale of hay, but a Baal. And, you know, an idol, boys and girls, is something that people make out to be a god, and it's not. The Bible tells us there is only one true God, only one. And everything else is just an idol. So it would be like me looking at this trophy going, I'm going to start worshiping this trophy, and I'm going to pray to this trophy, and I'm going to bow down to this trophy. The problem is, that trophy ain't God. That trophy is what? What is this, boys and girls? It's a trophy. Will it ever be anything other than a trophy? No. Can this trophy speak to me? No. Can this trophy work miracles? No. Can this trophy answer my prayers? No. So why in the world would the nation of Israel go after this Baal thing? Well, they did. And you know what? Elijah, God said, here's what I want you to do, Elijah. There are 450 prophets of Baal. And you alone are my only prophet in Israel left. I want you to go and confront them. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was Elijah, I'd have gone, wait a minute, those odds are 450 against one. God said, don't worry, Elijah, I'm with you. And so Elijah went to the king. His name was Ahab. And he went to Ahab and said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to call all the nation of Israel and tell them tomorrow we're going to meet at Mount Carmel. And we're going to find out once and for all who is really God. Is it God Almighty who created this earth? Or is it this Baal trophy guy? And so the next day, you can guess what happened. Look at the scene, boys and girls. There's this mountain. And the people are surrounding this mountain. And there are 450 prophets of Baal. And in walks little Elijah, all by himself. And he said, I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to have a showdown. And the people said, what kind of showdown? We're going to have a showdown amongst gods. He said, here's what we're going to do. He said, you prophets of Baal, there's 450 of you. You come with your idol, and you come with, what you do is you get your altar, and we're going to lay a sacrifice on it. In other words, they would cut up these animals, and they'd use them as sacrifices. Okay, kind of like a barbecue, okay? And he said, you lay it there, but don't put no fire under it. And then I'm going to do the same. And what we're going to do is then we're going to call and see which God lights the fire. And the prophets of Baal loved that because they thought they were going to win. And they said, okay. So they got their little altar together and they put the sacrifice up there. And they commenced, folks. They started praying and they started praying and they started praying. The Bible said they started in the morning and they went till noon. Now we're talking maybe 5-6 hours of them praying and calling on trophy God here to do this. And he didn't do it. You know why? Because he can't, because he's not a God. And so they kept praying, they kept praying. And old Elijah, buddy, he started gaining more confidence. And he knew what his God could do. And so he sits over there under the shade tree and he starts picking at him. He goes, hey, maybe you need to pray a little louder. Maybe your God's on vacation. Or maybe he has a busy schedule today and he can't get around to it. Or maybe, hey, maybe you need to wake him up. Maybe he's just sleeping. And he kept on, and they got more and more angry at that. And they kept on praying, and they kept on praying, they kept on praying. And guess what? Weren't no fire at all. And so about noon, Elijah stood up and he said, that's enough. You've had all the time you need to get Baal to answer. And I'm going to tell you, he ain't going to answer because he ain't no God. He said, now, Israel, come to me, and you're going to see that there is God in Israel. He is here. And so what he did is he rebuilt the altar that they used to sacrifice to God. You see, they had let it go. It had gotten knocked down and messed up because they were over there with the Baal guy, and nobody was over here taking care of the altar of God. And so he rebuilt the altar of God. And then he took that sacrifice and he put it on there. And guys, let me tell you something. Then Elijah did something. You'll never guess in a million years what Elijah wanted. He said, here's what I want you to do now. He said, I want you to go get some jugs of water. And they thought, what in the world does Elijah want jugs of water for a barbecue? And so Elijah said, come on. And so they found 4 jugs. Now, this is smaller than the jug they used, but they found 4 jugs, and Elijah said, fill them with water. And they filled them with water, and they said, well, what do we do? He said, come over here and pour them on the sacrifice. Just pour them on the sacrifice, and they did. And he said, all right, go do it again. They said, excuse me? He said, go pour them again. So they filled up these big jugs, and they poured them again. And they looked at Elijah, and he said, guess what? They said, you don't want us to do it again, do you? And he said, yes, I do. So they fixed those jugs up with water and they filled them and put them on there a third time. Now, I don't know. Let me get the math together. If you got 4 jugs and you pour it 3 times onto that fire, boys and girls, how many jugs of water is that? 4 times 3. Let's see. You got 4. You got 12. Am I right? I'm right. 12 jugs of water they poured on this barbecue grill, on this altar. And you know what happened? The water came up over it. And Elijah said, dig a trench. They dug a trench around it so that the water was like a little creek around it. And it was just nothing but water. Nothing but water. And so Elijah, the people, can you imagine what the people were thinking? Now, how in the world is something so wet going to get started with fire? And Elijah said, all right. He looked up and he said, Lord, today I want it to be known that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant and that I have done all these things at your word. You've told me to do all of this. Not me. It's not me doing it, Lord. It's you. So I'm asking you, Lord, to answer me. Answer me so that these people will know that you, oh Lord, you are God. And answer in such a way that you are going to turn their hearts back to you again. And do you know what happened when he got through praying? Well, let me tell you something. Fire came down from heaven. The Lord sent fire down, and the Bible says that the fire hit that altar and boom, it consumed the altar. It consumed the sacrifice. And the Bible says it was so much hot. It was so hot that it actually lapped up and licked up the water in the trough. Now, folks, I don't know about you, but if I was those people, I'd have been scared to death. Because here I was, worshiping this old trophy over here like it's some kind of God and ignoring the God who created the world, who brought the children of Israel out of Egypt, who gave them this nation and loved them and cared for them. And man, we turn over here and we start worshiping this other stuff. Can you imagine what they must have thought? You see, folks, listen. God was there. The only true God, the only God on that mountain was God Almighty, the creating God of this universe. Boys and girls, the God who sent His Son, Jesus Christ, into this world because He loves you, to die on a cross, to save us from our sins. That's who that God is, the only one God, the only true God. So I tell you what we're going to do is in just a moment, I'm going to get here and try to get some of this stuff dry a little bit so I can start this charcoal to cook y'all some burgers. And I'm going to go up and I'm going to see how my secret sauce is and put it on the grill. And when I come back, I'm going to tell you what the lessons are from this story. But you just think about it. Think about all that water and all the entire nation there. Can you imagine how those 450 prophets of Baal, how they thought, oh my goodness, we yelled and screamed for 6 hours. Our God wasn't going to hear us. You know why? Because He wasn't a God. He gets up. Elijah gets up, pours water all over this. And all he says is, Lord, I've done what you told me to. Now show these people your God. And you know what? He did. So I'll be back in just a minute and we'll talk about some lessons that we can learn from this, okay? I'll be right back. Hey, that's too big a fire. You're gonna burn the creek down. Do something. Secret sauce a bubbling, meats a cooking up there. I'm gonna come down here and get your burgers ready. But you know, let's go back to this story we talked about. Because you know, it's an incredible and amazing story how God sent that fire from heaven to show the nation of Israel that He is the one true God. So what lessons do we learn? Well, boys and girls, the first lesson we can learn from all of this is that there's only one God. There's a lot of things out there we can make real important. In fact, there are some things we can even make idols out of. We can act like they're gods of our lives. And we got to be careful of that. You know, some people I know who do like sports and stuff, if you're not careful, these trophies can become like a god to you. They can become more important to you than Jesus. And you have to be careful of that. But, you know, we have to understand that this lesson shows us one thing, that there is only one true God. And like I told you, He is the God who sent His Son. You know that verse, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him, man, they'll never perish, they'll live forever. You know? That's what our God does, the only one true God. And so, first off, you need to understand there's only one God. And He shows how much He loves you because He sent His Son to die on a cross for you. Second lesson we can learn is that God will always let people know who He is. Now, we live in a world where there's a lot of confusion about that. A lot of confusion about where is God? Well, folks, God is right here. He ain't gone anywhere. But He's always going to let us know. But you know what? In order for us to know and see God, we got to be looking for Him. He is active in this world. Look at people in your church. Look at how they pray. Look at how they praise. Look at how we worship. Man, we're letting people know God's around because He's in our hearts and in our lives. God is always going to do that. And that brings us to another point. If God is always going to let people know that He is God, that He is there, you know how He does it more than anything? He does it through us. People know God because we know God. And so therefore we become the ones that tell people about God. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, what happens is, guys, is this. It is so cool. God throws that on us. Jesus Christ comes and lives in our lives, and we have Him in us. And so therefore we become that miracle of God that they see. So how can you be that miracle? Well, let me give you a couple of reasons, a couple of ways to do it. If there's somebody in your life that mistreats you, and you're having a hard time loving, pray for them. Pray for them. Ask God to give you the strength of love, of His love to love them and to show who He is in your life. Maybe you got a friend that's going through a hard time. Maybe, I don't know, maybe his parents are getting divorced or they're having family problems or whatever, or they're being picked on. You can be that friend that goes up to them and says, let me pray for you. I want you to know that God is there with you. He's never going to leave you. And that's the third point we want to make on this, is that God, boys and girls, is always with you. He ain't going to leave you. He loves you. You don't leave what you love. And so God loves you perfectly. So that means He's never going to leave you, which means everywhere you go, God is there. And you can show anybody, anywhere, anytime, God. You just got to get to know Him a little bit. And that's where growth groups come in. That's where worship comes in. That's where the Bible comes in. That's where prayer comes in. That's where time at home with our moms and dads or whoever is raising you, you can spend with them learning the Bible. Man, there's a lot of ways to get to know God. But the first one, and the most important one, is that you ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be part of your life, to be in you. I don't know how exactly that happens, folks. God's God. He can do that. He ain't no trophy. He's God. And the Bible tells us when we ask Jesus to come into our lives and we accept what He did on the cross, He forgives us of our sins and He comes and lives in us forever. Which means we don't go through life just us. We go through life with God in us. And folks, I'm going to tell you something. If we got a God who can bring down fire and light up the water and do all those cool things, think about what He can do through you if you'll just let Him. He loves you. He loves you, boys and girls. And He wants you to know Him. So I thank the Lord for that day of that showdown up on Mount Carmel, where God said, let me show you that I'm God. And He'll do it through you if you just will let Him and have that relationship with Him. Okay? So let's pray. Father, we thank You so much for every boy and girl and every family that's watching this right now. I pray that they will understand how great of a God You are, how awesome You are, and that we thank You for loving us and proving that love for us by sending Jesus Christ to die on the cross for us so that we can be forgiven of our sins and that, Lord, we can let You live in us. And all we got to do is give You that invitation. Lord, I want You in my life and I thank You for the cross. Something that simple, and He will live in your life forever. And we thank You, Lord, that You are a God who always shows who You are. And I thank You that now, more than ever, You choose to show who You are through the people and the boys and girls who love You. And so, Lord, show us how to do that this week. We love You, Jesus. We thank You. Oh, You're an awesome, great God. You are the only awesome, great God. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, guys, that's our story. It looks like my charcoal's about dry. So I'm going to start this one up. We'll get some hamburgers, hot dogs, and chicken fingers going, but we're going to go up there and check on the barbecue, and I'm going to kind of look at the other folks and see if they got anything that looks good. But I guarantee you, listen, I guarantee you, this trophy going to be Cookie Joe's again this year. And so when you come down to the snack shack, I show it to you, okay? And I may just put a little barbecue out there for you to eat because it's going to have the special sauce, okay? Listen. Spend some time with Jesus this week. Pray. read your Bible. Come to church if you can. And we want you. We want you to know that Jesus Christ loves you, okay? I got to go up there before they burn the whole forest down, okay? I'll see you next week, okay? Bye-bye, boys and girls.
What'd you think, kids, about that story that old Cookie Joe told us? You know, it's only Almighty God who could do what He did in that story. He called fire down from heaven, and He not only took care of the sacrifice, but He licked up all the water that was poured on the sacrifice. Only Almighty God can do that, and He's the only one that we can describe as Almighty. Hey, remember when we were talking earlier about the sand in your hand if you were down at the beach? Remember that? And we talked about how many grains of sand could you have in your hand when you have a handful of sand? I tell you what, if you counted them all, it would be a lot. Because the grains of sand, they're real small. And your hand is getting bigger all the time, isn't it? Well, you know what? Just imagine not only counting the grains of sand in your hand at the beach, but imagine counting all the sand that's on the beach as far as you can see this way. As far as you can see this way when you go to the beach. Just imagine how big of a number that would be. Now imagine this. Think about not only that beach, but think about every beach that is on this entire planet. Every beach next to every ocean all around the world. Now what if you counted the grains of sand that were on all those beaches around the world? How many grains of sand do you think you'd find? Well, you know, that's a way bigger math problem than what old Rusty can handle. But you know what the scientists tell us? The scientists tell us that the number of grains of sand that are on all the beaches around the world is just about the same number as the number of stars in the universe. Can you imagine? Have you ever looked up at stars and just looked and tried to guess how many there are? And you know what? We can't even begin to see all of them that are really out there. But you know what? The Bible says that God spoke and every one of those stars came into being. Now, scientists also tell us they think they know about how many stars there are in the universe. You want to see the number? Here it is. I got it in my trusty tackle box right here. Old Rusty's got it for you. Old Rusty's taking care of you. Here it is. That's how many stars that scientists say are in the universe. Now, that's a whole lot bigger number than old Rusty can figure out. Maybe you can figure it out and you can tell me sometime when you see me what that number is. But that's a whole bunch of stars. And you know what? The Bible says that not only did God speak and all those stars just came into being just at the power of His Word, not only that, the Bible says that He named every star and He knows the stars by name. Now, how amazing is that? That means every one of them, every one of these stars, just about the same number of stars as there are grains of sand on all the beaches throughout the world, all these stars, God knows their name. He gave them a name and He knows their name. We serve an awesome God. And you know what? That reminds me of our memory verse that we've been working on over these last couple weeks. Do you remember what it is? Well, I'll tell you what. I'll put it on the screen and let's read it together. Here we go. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. You know, we talked about it last time, that this Bible verse says that we should not fear, we should not be worried, because God is taking care of us with His righteous right hand. That means everything He does to take care of you, He does it right. It's going to be good for Him, and it's going to be great for you. He is taking care of you. Now, here's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to read this verse a couple times, but we're going to do some fun stuff with it. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to put the words up on the screen, and each time as we read it, we're going to do something fun while we're reading the verse. So make sure that you're reading the verse while you're doing it. So the first thing we're going to do is I'm going to ask you just to jump up and down while we're saying the verse. Now, if you've got a brother or sister next to you, let's see which one of you can jump the highest, okay? So I'm going to put the words up on the screen. All right, you start jumping and let's say it together. Here we go. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. All right, good job. You can stop jumping now. All right, so let's try something different this time. I tell you what, take one hand and just start patting your head. And I want you to take your other hand and rub your stomach, okay? Can you do that at the same time? Pat your head and rub your stomach at the same time? All right, so while you're doing that, and keep going, we're going to say the verse together. Here we go. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. All right, good. You can stop that now. All right, so we're going to do one more thing as we read the verse the last time. We're going to ask you to jump up and down, but this time, jump on one foot. You can jump on your right foot or your left foot, whichever one you'd rather do, or you can start with one and then switch to the other, or you can go back and forth. It doesn't matter. But jumping up and down on one foot. All right, get ready. Start jumping. Now let's say the verse. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. All right, good job, y'all. Y'all can stop jumping now. I tell you what, you're doing a good job with this verse. I hope that you'll have it memorized. It's so important to know God's thoughts, to have God's Word memorized in your heart, in your mind, so that you can know how much God cares for you. I tell you what, it's been a good night here at the Creek, and I'm so glad that you were a part of it. We're going to sing another song, and we'll see you next week down here at the Creek.
People have just heard that Jesus paid that price so we could have it.